One memorial that I'd like to refer to now is in Ohio. And it was an infidel. I forget his name. I got the picture somewhere there in my collection at home, where he was so firmly against Christianity that he wanted a memorial built to him after his death with his foot on the Bible, pointing down like that, and saying, away with religious superstitions and up with modern science. And when he was dying, he said, if I've been wrong, serpents will crawl out of my grave. And when he died, they were still shoving the dirt into the grave, and they killed two or three big vipers. And today in that graveyard, a minister taken a picture recently and brought it to show me, and hanging over the chains around his lock, the graveyard is a beautiful place, but his mound is nothing but a snake mound. And no matter, even into the fall and winter, serpents still crawl from his grave. A memorial. God forbid me ever have a memorial like that, or any of you. So there is memorials, though.
It sounded like a very interesting story, so I decided to do a little research. Chester Beadle had been very outspoken and bold in his lack of belief. In the stretch of time in his sad, faithless life, he declared often that there was no God, and that he would never believe in one. Most often the Christian neighbors, as they passed his home on Sundays, going to church, everyone that knew him called him mean and cruel. No one dared to cross him for the fear that their homes would be burnt down. Beadle even went as far to construct an idol of himself, a monument of solid bronze. In his uplifted right hand were inscribed these words, Universal Mental Liberty. Beneath the left foot, he depicted a scroll representing the Bible with the inscription, Superstition. He was heard saying away with religious superstitions and up with modern science. Before his death in 1908, at the age of 82, Beadle declared vehemently that there was no such thing as God. But, as a passing jab at his creator, he made this final remark. If there is a God, or any truth in the Bible, let my body be infested with snakes. At the funeral, it became necessary, while digging, to remove a big snake before lowering his coffin into the ground. While digging, they encountered a den of snakes, so bad concrete had been brought in to stop the writhing creatures, but to no avail. What became more miraculous was when the sexton informed them that prior to this burial, he had never seen any snakes around. And he had killed four at one time, in this particular grave, 20 in just one day. Gerald Winrod, editor of The Defender, had the opportunity to visit the grave site of Chet Beadle. He drove to Berlin Center, Ohio, where he stopped an old-timer, and asked if he knew where Chet Beadle had been buried. Sure, everybody around here knows where Chet Beadle was buried, the old man replied. A few miles south, then turn to the right, then left about a mile, then to the right, then turn to the right again just before getting into North Benton, about 80 miles from Pittsburgh. You can't miss a big monument in the graveyard. Looking for snakes, he asked, grinning. Another man that spoke to Winrod remarked, well, if Beadle did ask for snakes, he sure got him. Winrod and his companions approached the gravesite. Then they saw the huge monument, the stern bronze countenance, the uplifted scroll, in the statue's right hand, the scroll, beneath his left foot. Camera in hand, Winrod approached the grave, curiosity mounting. Was this really true, or just another hoax? One of Winrod's companions, Mystery E. Flowers, was. As they walked around the gravesite, they counted six of the snakes, one which Mr. Flowers killed, and another Winrod photographed. Garter and black snakes, the black snakes nearly 7 feet long. The neighbors seeing the steady stream of photographers informed the tourists that it seemed as if the more snakes they killed, the more abundantly they returned. Since the day Beetle was lowered into the ground, the grave lot has been filled with angry, sinister snake holes. Beetle's daughter had informed a visiting minister that her father had belonged to the Society of Damned Souls, but that on his deathbed, he had regretted his decision to erect the statue at his soon-to-be gravesite, saying, "Oh, that I had never had that monument built," and was said to have desired to go to the cemetery and tear it down. But it was too late, and he was too stubborn to call on a god he didn't believe in. One neighbor informed Winrod that Beetle had been involved in 21 lawsuits while living, and that he had owned approximately 2,500 acres of land in the community at his death. It is said that he had left $1 each to his Christian daughters and the 2,500 acreage to his unbelieving sons. Kinda brings to mind Mark 8:36 Hut. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What a remarkable story. I know. How heartbreaking it is that Mr. Chet Beetle has since become aware of God's existence, as today he is tormented by legions of demons in a fiery hell. To see this looming monument in pictures, a terrific storm had taken down the statue and it has never been re-erected, and to read about Rev. William Smith's visit with Chet Beetle before his death, visit Part 2 of Rev. Smith's story are pictures of the snakes. Article by John Greenhate. Thank you.